Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the breakout session for the Netherlands. I'm your moderator. My name is Frank Stalens. I'm the founder of the whistleblowingmanagement.eu network. Now, we have decided to hold this session in English, just to open it up also for non-Dutch speaking participants. But we are all Dutch speaking, so if at the end you have any questions in Dutch, please go ahead. Now, EQS Group managed to line up some quite interesting speakers for you. And perhaps we can go to the next slide. So, we have Manon from Rabobank, who did some quite interesting research on the effect of organizational leaders on employee voicing and silencing. She will be introduced by Mario van den Broek, who's globally responsible for whistleblowing policies at Rabobank. And she will, or both ladies, will be followed by Geert Vermeulen from the Integrity Coordinator. And then last but not least, Rikje Nollen from Fields. So we will bring presentations of between 10 to 15 minutes, just to leave time for Q&A at the end. Now, if you have any questions during the presentations, please already enter them into the Q&A pane, which you see on your right, so that we can already start selecting and prioritizing them. And again, if you want to ask them in Dutch, please. We will be able to handle them at the end of the four sessions. Thank you very much, Mario. The floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. Equity is not limited to one particular sector or industry. It's important for everyone. Can you go to the next slide, Lucia? Next slide, please. Thank you. Even though organizations most likely have a code of conduct and want to do the right thing, you see that things still go wrong. These articles out of newspapers and from the internet prove that. Even the disaster of 9/11 was reported internally before it actually happened, and nothing was done with it. Almost every day, we hear about incidents globally that have a huge impact on the success of and trust in an organizational government body. Our presentation is about the importance of employee voice to mitigate the risks of incidents happening. In a moment, Manon, my colleague, will talk about the drivers that have an impact on employee voice and the importance of true leadership. Can we go to the next slide? Lucia? The importance of employee voice, and it's all about adaptability. As Charles Darwin said, it's not the strongest of the species that survives, nor the most intelligent that survives. It's the one that's the most adaptable to change. If an organization doesn't know something needs to change, it cannot react to it, so nothing will change. Next slide, please, Lucia. The importance of employee voice. Customers want to do business with ethical organizations. Employee silence has been implicated as a contributor to a host of detrimental outcomes, including weak performance, corruption, low employee morale, and accidents. If people keep their mouths shut, disasters can happen. We read that in the articles. Employee voice, on the other hand, enables better decision making. When we're talking about diversity, it's not just about gender or age. It's also about diversity of way of thinking. It contributes, employee voice contributes to the organization's effectiveness. When different people look at the same thing in different ways, it's about diversity of thinking, and only then we will have a full picture of this. Today's businesses are operating in a fast-changing environment. The COVID-19 pandemic, rapid technology changes, globalizations, they all have their effect on businesses and their ability to survive. In this fast-changing environment, therefore, adaptability is key. I think we go to a poll at this moment. Maybe you can put it on the screen, Lucia. We like to be this to be an interactive session. So let's ask a question from you, the public. What is the most important reason that employees don't speak up? Is it not knowing the channels, not feeling safe? Maybe it's peer pressure, or they just don't care. Let's see your answers. We'll give you a couple of seconds to answer this question. I don't see any results yet. Maybe there is an answer. Maybe others want to answer it. Yeah, no. Or maybe the technology is not cooperating. Seems that we have one answer, or at least people are answering the same thing, not feeling safe. Well, I'll leave the word to Manon to talk about that more.
Yes, thank you. We can go to the next slide, please. It's interesting that you say not feeling safe, because what I expected was the answer of not knowing the channels, because in communicating about whistleblowing, about speaking up, about issues, always not knowing the channels gets the most attention. But indeed, not feeling safe is the biggest impediment for employees to speak up. We saw in our research that only 8% of employees say not knowing the channels is an impediment to speak up. So 92% don't see it as an impediment and have other things in mind, such as not feeling safe, but also peer pressure is involved, disengagement is involved, and managers' actions are involved. Also interesting is that an employee will speak up on moral ethical issues regardless of the consequence when they cannot live with the concern. So not feeling safe has its limits. If I cannot live with the fact that something happened, I will speak up regardless. Also, the topic of the issue matters, and more specifically, the effect it has on the person speaking up. So, if I strongly feel about a certain issue, it doesn't have to be a moral issue or something that's very wrong. If it really matters to me, I will speak up as well. Employee silence is widespread. We saw in research articles that between 70 and 85% of employees say that they have not spoken up, although they have information that can help the company. So companies can improve enormously if they have the right information. We also saw that silence is systemic, but we also know that employee voice is systemic. So, silence, if I don't speak up about an issue, I it has an effect on other times. So I won't speak up about other issues. And if I don't speak up, my colleagues won't speak up. So it will spread from person to person and from topic to topic. So it gets, it turns into a spiral of silence. But the beautiful thing is that voice is also systemic, so you can turn it around into a spiral of voice. I will go into the drivers in a bit to tell you how you can turn silence into voice. But one of the things that's really important is an employee or a CEO speaking up. We saw that if a CEO is standing up for an issue and he's really inspiring in doing so, he also inspires other people in the company to speak up about issues. So it can help. We also learned in our research that employees want to speak up to their manager or to their colleagues. And they only go to a channel like a platform or a telephone hotline if they cannot go to their manager, if they're involved, or if they don't feel safe. They said it feels like an escalation of the situation. And we first want to talk to our colleagues or to our managers ourselves. Sorry. Let's go into the drivers. We saw four main drivers in our research. We can go to the next slide, please. These drivers are attitude, so I want to speak up, capability, I'm able to speak up, safety, I feel safe to speak up, and social cues, so the actions or words of other people. Let's first look at the attitude section. It consists of beliefs and expectations of employees. To speak up, an employee makes a decision consciously or unconsciously to want to speak up. The factors that play a role in this are self-confidence, the power, so office politics, I withhold information intentionally, or disengagement of the employee, and the fact that it has to be worth the effort. So the issue must be handled adequately and something must change. The most important action to change silence into speech is to drive employee engagement and to act upon signals. If you look at the capability section, it consists of feeling of control and the possibility of speaking up. An employee has to be able to speak up, capability, but it's not the practical sense of being able to speak up. So it's a hygiene factor that you have to know where to go, but more importantly, it has to feel easy to speak up. So it's more a psychological thing than a practical or technical thing. If we look at the safety section, the problem for employees is that they stay silent because they fear the risks of speaking up, so job loss or loss of reputation. And we have to trust our manager or our organization to speak up. So this a big thing for managers to think about. They have to create a safe environment. Now look at the last section, social cues. This consists of norms and signals of mainly managers and colleagues. Social cues such as manager encouragement, support from colleagues, peer pressure can help or hamper speaking up. Positive role modeling, deeply ingrained social norms, peer pressure, and support from others can also come to play. The silence of colleagues, but also speaking up of colleagues, influences the decision to stay silent or to speak up. And this is a very important thing in the spiral of silence or the spiral of voice, that the social cues can help your organization to turn that spiral. So to summarize, let's go to the next slide, please. Getting employees to speak up is important for every company, whether to make the right decisions, take a stance on societal issues, or to detect fraud or other misconduct. Our research indicates that we need to do more than just provide reporting channels and the knowledge where to find the information. Our recommendation is that one should work on all four drivers to battle the silence in an organization. Whether the company is a large corporate or an SME, it is important to create an open culture or open communication climate in which people feel safe to speak up. They want to speak up, encourage each other to speak up as well. Organizational leadership and managers play a crucial role. Managers have a key position to turn a spiral of silence into a spiral of voice. A manager sets the standard of what is accepted in a team. They have a certain power over their employees. The organizational climate can be positively or negatively influenced by the behavior at the top. The leader or manager needs to be empathic, listen to its employees, and connect with them. They have to be clear what the standard is, what the shared goal is, and be inspiring, open, and willing to listen. They have to take a reporter signal seriously, take action, and handle adequately for an employee to speak up. They need to be flexible and adapt their style to what is needed at a particular moment. A manager has to create an open communication environment, but he or she cannot do this on his own. It takes a team effort to realize this goal of creating an open communication climate. And there, other people like compliance advisors, communication advisors, HR people come into play. A manager needs to surround them with the right people that want to speak up and tell them what others won't. Because the higher a manager gets in the organization, the less employees are willing to tell them. And they have to get people around them that want to tell them the truth. Because one speaking up is saying the thing that others won't, but they will think as well. So, leaders have to be more empathic, show ethical leadership, they have to walk the talk, show exemplary behavior, they have to be vulnerable and ask their employees for feedback.
Yeah, our last slide, Lucia.
Yeah.
As Manon said, it is very important to include all four drivers in the battle against employee silence. And they all have an influence on the spiral. So as a manager or leader, it's easy for employees to voice their opinion, invite them, encourage them, speak up, ask the questions, discuss dilemmas, value the feedback and input. Your employees on the floor, they know what's going on. Act on it. As I said, even 9/11 was reported internally by an FBI agent who wanted to do a house search, and it was denied. And we all know what the result of it was. Show commitment, support, don't wave things away, allow mistakes, learn from them. The adaptability comes back again. And for advisors, tell managers what others will not. Put the unspoken issues on the management agenda. Be a contrarian. Turn the spiral of silence into the spiral of voice. Thank you.
Thank you, Manon and Mario. I think we can now move on to the next speaker, Lucia. So if you could. move on the slides.
I think there are some technical issues.
Yeah, I think so too. So the next speaker, please continue with the presentation, and then we'll just catch up with the slides when we get the technical side back up and running again.
Shall I take over, Geert? Of Geert, Frank? Ah, there it is.
Please, yeah, please do. Go ahead.
That's fine. Yes, I'm a lawyer, so I will fill you in on the legal background of whistleblowing, because we've just heard from Manon and Mario that there should be a speak up culture, but the basis in an employer-employee relationship is still that employees should shut up about what they hear within the company. Most of the employees will have a provision in their employment contract saying that they should keep everything that they hear in the context of their employment silent. So what whistleblowing arrangements do, they basically lift that obligation in exceptional circumstances, and employees will under these circumstances be allowed to speak up. We've had the privilege in the Netherlands of having a whistleblowing arrangement in place, a law in place already for quite some years, not a lot, it's approximately 6 years. But there is good news, because the EU has issued a directive which will now create a basis for the whole of Europe, a mandatory basis to have whistleblowing arrangements incorporated in their legislation. The directive needs to be implemented by mid-December of this year, but it looks like a lot of countries will not be able to reach that deadline. And basically, the goal of the directive is to enhance the protection of whistleblowers by introducing common minimum standards. So it's a minimum. Member states are allowed to provide more protection to whistleblowers than the directive requires. Can you go to the next slide? Yeah, this is an outline of the progress that is made in the relevant EU countries with the implementation of the directive. The Netherlands is green, but that is a comparison. So compared to other countries, we are probably a bit more progressed. But honestly, we are not yet there. I mean, there is a proposal of law that has been presented to the to Parliament. But all kinds of organizations have been given the opportunity to respond to the proposal. The political parties have been given the opportunity to respond. They've done so, as a matter of fact, last Friday. And what is clear from these from the responses is that we are not ready yet to implement a law. We have the Wet Klokkenluiders, Huis voor de Klokkenluiders in place now, and that is up for evaluation. The government should actually already have made a lot of progress with the evaluation, but that regretfully is not the case. So what we hear from political parties and from all kinds of interested organizations is that they think it is a missed opportunity to now start changing the current law without having done the evaluation of the existing law, because it's not really going very smoothly currently. So that is one of the main objections that is made against the fact that the government has laid down this proposal of law. What the proposal does is basically implementing the directive and making some changes to the current system, but it's not rewriting the law, also taking into account the evaluation. So the general opinion is, let's miss the deadline. On average, we have missed every deadline when implementing EU directives with approximately 1 year. So let's do it. let's do it here as well. Not sure whether that is a good thing. Fact remains that we have a whistleblowing law in place, so there is some form of framework already. So to that extent, we are whistleblowers are a bit protected, but it would be good to have the implementation of the directive ASAP. What will change as a result of the directive? Can you put the next slide in? The big difference between the what is arranged for in the EU directive and what we have in Dutch law is the topic of whistleblowing. The current law that we have basically says that I've been thinking about the correct word in English is misstand in Dutch, and I hope that everyone on the that the audience will understand what that means. But it's like, it's not abuse, it's not, no, let's call it a misstand. So these are general situations within companies that are how can you describe it, contrary to the societal interest. That's a general topic. In the EU directive, the whistleblowing legislation only needs to cover violations of EU law. So laws implemented in the various countries that are based on EU directives. So the new law will need to expand the topics for which whistleblowing can be done to these topics. Another change is that the protection, that the group of whistleblowers that will receive protection will be much broader than under the current legislation. Currently, only employees with a direct relationship are covered. Under the new law, that will be much broader because it will be also third parties related to that individual. Still, there needs to be some link to the employment relationship. Another big change that will be implemented as a result of the directive is that the current Dutch law requires employees to first report internally, and then only after that has been done and the company has not responded appropriately, employees can report externally. Under the directive, employees can simply choose. They can choose whether they want to go first to through the internal channels of their employer or whether they immediately want to go to an external channel. And that actually emphasizes the importance of having appropriate systems in place. So an arrangement that everyone understands, an arrangement that provides the sufficient comfort to employees that if they report, that things will be treated appropriately. A culture within the organization that actually encourages employees to first go and resolve things internally before taking the external route. So that is due to the implementation of the after the implementation of the EU directive, this will be super important. So let me see. Another important change is that so if you are a whistleblower and you've reported something, then you are protected from retaliation, and that is can mean a lot: dismissal, demotion, but also things like, if you are, as a customer, put on a blacklist because of a whistleblowing exercise, these are all forms of retaliation that are basically prohibited. And the whistleblower is given extra protection because of a reversal of the burden of proof. So if you are a whistleblowing or a related person and you encounter some form of retaliation by the company, then basically what you can do, you can, as a whistleblower, say, this is a form of retaliation. And if you say that, then it's basically up to the company to defend itself. Let me see. Confidentiality will, under the EU implementation, apply automatically. Currently, whistleblowers actually have to ask for the information to be kept confidential, but that will now be an automatic standard. And the powers of the Huis voor Klokkenluiders will be extended. Currently, the external organization that you will have to go to if you want to make an external reporting is het Huis voor de Klokkenluiders. Once the EU legislation will be implemented, then there will be, the government will have to appoint for each violation of each different topic of EU law, a different external reporting channel. So, for example, if you decide to, if for example, your employer is violating antitrust legislation, then the external channel for reporting that would be in the Netherlands, the AFM. If you find out that your employer is not doing anything against significant data leaks, then the external reporting channel will be the Data Protection Authority. So for each of these topics, there will be an authority appointed and it will be set out in the law. And the bucket, so if there is no specific authority appointed in the law, the rest bucket will be the Huis voor de Klokkenluiders, and then you can report there. One thing to bear in mind, so you have internal reporting, external reporting, and only if these two channels will not work, you will be allowed as an employee to report or to make your concerns public. If you don't follow the right procedures and if you just line up an interview with a television station or you send your complaints to a newspaper, then you do run the risk that you will not be protected as a whistleblower and that you can be confronted with the terms that are included in your employment agreement that basically say that you should have shut up. So that is still, as a whistleblower, you can speak up, but you need to do that carefully and not unnecessarily harm the reputation of your employer or related party. Let me see if I have anything else to say. In the current legislative proposal, the legislator has chosen to not introduce one procedure for reporting, but they've said we are going to leave the current procedure for the general misstand in place, and we're going to have a separate procedure where it concerns, or different rules where it concerns violations of EU law. And the primary difference between the two will be that the mandatory response time for the employer in case of a whistleblowing report is not defined where it concerns general reports, so misstanden. The law only states that, or the proposal of law only states that the employer must, within a reasonable time, confirm the receipt of the report, and then within a reasonable time say when or what measures will be made. If you look at the directive and where it concerns violations of EU law, there are clear deadlines. After 7 days, there has to be a confirmation of receipt of the report. And then after 3 months, the employer will need to provide an update to the reporter, to the whistleblower. And if you don't do that as an employer, then you are actually at risk, because then the floor is open for the whistleblower to make an external communication. So that's where your reputation can really be harmed. one of the concerns of the parties commenting on the proposal of law, the whistleblowing proposal, is that things are made unnecessarily complicated by having these, by keeping two different sets of rules. One of the comments is, in general, that the law is very complicated. I kind of agree, but then laws are often very complicated. And that's where I think companies should provide a translation between the law and the practice. So that's why it is so important. I mean, there will be not be any employee who reads the law to see how he should make a report. Employees will look at the employer and they will look at the whistleblowing procedure that is in place within the employer. That procedure, of course, needs to meet the law. So employers will need to probably consult with lawyers to hear what they have to do, which personally I don't think is a big problem because I earn my bread and butter with it. But in the end, the translation needs to be made in, and I see that I have to wrap up, but this is the last thing that I'm going to say, but in the end, the company needs to make the translation to the employee, the workforce, and make sure that they have something in place that is clear. And now I'll hand over to Geert, because Geert will tell us more on how in practice you can make sure that that the whistleblowing procedure will be effective. And, so the floor is yours, Geert.
Yes, thank you, Brechtje. And yes. Hopefully my sound is working now. My microphone is working now. Good, because we had a few problems a bit earlier on. So thank you, everybody. My name is Geert Vermeulen. Hi. So I want to elaborate a little bit further on also what Manon and Mario were saying. So about the spiral of voice. I like that term. And I often say unleashing the power of a speak up culture. And so we want to encourage people to speak up, and there are a couple reasons for that. First of all, if people speak up, you will hear about problems at an earlier stage. And I also think it's part of an important, it's an important part of an ethical culture, creating a culture of trust. So we want to encourage people to report internally instead of to the authorities. So with the new legislation, there's no legal obligation anymore to first report internally. So we want to encourage people to report internally first. And also research has shown that companies with more reports have better business results. So as an organization, you want to receive as many reports as possible, but how can you do that? So if we can move to the next slide. So if you think about, okay, so why do people not report? Also going back to the research of Manon. So what is holding people back? Well, they are afraid of the consequences. They are afraid they might be fired or there will be reputational damage or nobody will speak with them again. So, or another reason is they think nobody else is doing this, or they saw bad things happening to whistleblowers, or maybe they think nothing will happen if they file a report. Or perhaps they don't know how to report. Now that can be easily overcome. So if we go to the next slide. So so you can make it easy for people to report. So like, for example, making the procedure easily accessible to anyone. So what I usually see as a best practice is to put your whistleblowing procedure on your external website. So everybody can see it and everybody can report a violation of the law or a violation of the code of conduct. I always advise my clients to roll out an easy to understand reporting procedure. So think of a good name, like, for example, Ethics Helpline, Speak Up Procedure. Those are my two favorite ones. And try to avoid a lot of legal text. So try to avoid legal jargon that might be challenging or difficult for people to read. If you still want to comply with the Dutch law, that might be a little bit challenging because the Dutch law is sometimes very specific, as Brechtje said, on what needs to be in the procedure. But let me know. So I've made a couple, sample reporting procedures that are still quite small and easy to read. And also make it possible to report anonymously. You cannot retaliate against somebody if you don't know their identity. So if people are afraid to speak up, ensure that they are that they can file an anonymous report. It would be good to do that through a third-party service provider. So if people log in on your own website, you can always trace back IP addresses and things like that. So it would be good to use a third-party service provider there. If we go to the next slide. So also important is the leadership, as Manon already said, and Mario. So it's important to really protect the reporters and the identity of the reporters, and to conduct a solid investigation. So not just because the law says so, but because you really want to do that. So make sure that those investigations, that they are conducted fairly, independently, thoroughly. Do not try to shuffle things under the carpet. So and invite employees to report as soon as possible, so at an early stage. So my experience is that if an employee is already for 80% out of the door, it will be difficult to still be able to protect them. So try to invite them to report at an early stage. Because that will make it, you have a bit more time to investigate. And also important is to treat similar cases in the same way, have some organizational fairness. So employees experience that when they make the report, the organization handles it in a fair way. Another last thing is to ensure to create trust in the reporting procedure. So also demonstrate what happens with the reports. I think Manon also said a couple things about that. So it is important to provide regular feedback to the reporter. So when a report comes in, the law says that you should report, you should confirm within 7 days and provide substantial feedback within 3 months. I would say when a report comes in, I try to provide feedback as soon as possible, preferably within a couple hours, but definitely within 24 hours. What I also do is report back the statistics. So report what comes out of the whistleblowing procedure and demonstrate how much you appreciate that people undertake that effort to speak up. By the way, in the Netherlands, and I know that not everybody is aware of that, but there is already a rule that says that you have to submit an annual report to the Works Council. So that is already part of the law. Why not use that annual report to make something out of that and show how you appreciate that people speak up? Sometimes it also makes sense to describe an anonymized case once in a while, so that will not always be possible. So not all cases can be. I would not really recommend to do that with every case, but sometimes you have a case where you think, oh, yeah, this case went really well. And then, show what you have been doing with that case. So describe somebody made a report and this is what we did. Give that feedback to all of the organization. And even better, if the opportunity is there, celebrate the reporter. So sometimes you are just very, very happy that somebody submitted the report, and maybe that somebody wouldn't mind to reveal its his or her identity. So put them on a stage and say, okay, so this person, he or her spoke up. And we are just very happy that he or she did so. In that way, you can promote an open culture. One of the things that I also did in the past is one time I was very, very happy with the whistleblower. And I invited the person to the global leadership meeting. So the global leadership meeting is usually somewhere in a nice place. Where the top 50 or top 100 people, the top 100 managers, they sit together. And put on stage the whistleblower. The person is also going to go back to the office after the weekend, and he or she will have a great story to tell his or her colleagues, like, oh, I was at the global leadership meeting, huh? Were you? Yes. And people were so happy that I spoke up. So, you know, that's just free advertising. and keep on repeating that message. Yeah? So I know that when I send out compliance communications, I always put a little line at the bottom saying, okay, so if you are worried about anything, use the speak up procedure, and here is the address or the telephone number. And make it personal. So of course, I was lucky to say, when I provided a presentation, I would always end the presentation by saying, like, okay, so if you are worried about something, you can go to the whistleblowing procedure. A report will come in, and you know who handles the report. It will be me. And then sometimes, let's say within 1 or 2 hours after the presentation, I would already get the first couple of reports. So people thought, okay, so apparently people have trusted me. Okay, so I think let's go to the next slide. And I think, I will just spend 1 or 2 minutes on this one. I think it's a nice story. So what you see here is the inside of the toilet door. So what happens at a given moment is when I was working at a company and I saw a sudden uptick, a rise of the number of reports coming in from Africa. And I was like, huh, what's happening there? What's happening in Africa? So are things getting worse? Do we have problems in our organization in Africa? So what's going on? And it took me a while before I realized that we had a new HR manager in Africa. And what she did is that she traveled around the region. And she went to every head office, and every head office, she put a poster on the back of the toilet door. So people would go to the toilet, sit down for a while, reflect on what they were doing. They would look at the toilet door and see the speak up poster. And they think, oh, yeah, actually, I have something to report. And that proved to be very effective. Last tip. Posters on toilet doors. So I think that's it for me for now. So Frank, I would say back to you.
Thank you, Geert. I think we have 13 minutes left for some questions. So to the audience, if you have any questions, please put them into the Q&A pane. I will kick off with a couple of questions. So we heard from Manon that the organizational leaders hold the key for employee or proper employee voicing. Now, on the other hand, the regulations are pushing or aiming to pass this key to somebody, to case handlers that are independent from the business. So, do you have any opinion about that? I have my own opinion, which I will give in a couple of minutes, but just to ask your opinion first.
Well, what we saw is that an employee wants to talk to their manager first. They want to do it in a more informal manner. If the manager or leader is not involved in the situation, so then you don't have to deal with the law in such a strict manner, because it's just normal employee leadership talk about what's going good or what should improve. But if you if there's a hotline or speaker platform or more formal complaint, then you have to deal with rules and regulations. And then anonymous reporting is a great tool to have. Maybe you want to add something, Marion?
No, I think that's pretty complete. It is key, therefore, also that a manager towards his people is very clear on what people can expect from him or her, and vice versa. And what does the manager tolerate or does not tolerate? And so it's also easier then to go into dialogue about things if that's clear up front. And I think employees, the law, they find very complicated and often not. Well, you know, for the normal person on the floor, it's often very complicated to read because it's legal language. And they want, as Manon said, they want the informal interaction with the manager first and only escalate if they don't, if they're not listened to.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else has an opinion about this? But I can already perhaps also give you mine, and then you can also reflect on this. I think it in my opinion, it depends on the severity of the case. If you're talking about normal concerns, I absolutely agree that having the right culture, having the right organizational leadership is probably the most important factor. Now, the closer we get to illegal facts or illegal acts, the more I believe it needs to be the right combination of, on the one hand, culture, but also on the other hand, regulations and secure systems. Because in these kind of cases, illegal acts, and as also shown in the poll and the answer that we got, we only got a limited number of answers, but anyway, it also showed that the main concern is safety, and we need common standards, protection standards for this, which are embedded in the new regulations that are issued by the EU. But anyway, so that's my opinion. I don't know if anybody else would like to reflect on this.
Yes, Frank. So indeed. It is very important that the leadership creates an environment in which it is safe for people to report. Indeed, and they they have to show by example. So, like for example, also, maybe they can share something that went wrong, a mistake that they made, just to demonstrate that. Everybody makes mistakes, and it's okay to talk about that. I know at a given moment that the Dutch Financial Services Authority, the AFM, they implemented this culture of openly admitting mistakes, where at a given moment they said, once a month we're just going to open the agenda and talk about the biggest mistake that everybody made. And then at the end of the year, they nominated a person for the fuck up award. So there was somebody from the Financial Services Authority who won the annual fuck up award. So I met that person, and she was talking about that very proudly. Yes, yeah, I won the prize. So how about that for an open speak up culture? Yeah.
Yeah, Geert, I agree with you that is a way to create a culture. But what Frank is saying, the real whistleblowing issues that society also has an interest in of learning, these are really, really serious issues, and also serious from a company perspective. Because if someone opens up and basically reports things that are actually not true. I mean, a good story doesn't have to be true. So you can have a lot of reputational damage as a company. So I think that the rules, I think proper legislation is very important, but I also think that a whistleblowing policy that properly sets out things and educating people on what they should and should not do is an important element of making your whistleblowing procedure a successful one, because I think that companies also need to be protected against vexatory whistleblowing report. So it needs to be not only speak up, speak up, speak up, but also make clear what people can and cannot do to avoid that a lot of reputational damage is done where this should not be necessary. And also because if employees speak up when they actually had no cause to speak up, hunting season is open. They will have real issues as well. So I'm not an overly legalistic person in itself, and I'm very much for pragmatic solutions, but also the rules are not to be ignored, like Frank said.
I have another question for you, Brechtje. And
Frank?
Yeah, sorry.
Can we just a little bit about it? Because we agree with Brechtje, but that's in a situation where it already escalates. And what I was talking about is that some situations or issues can be prevented if we have a great discussion and an open culture before the situation escalates. Because if Volkswagen handled the issue of the diesel gate in an earlier stage and they changed their behavior, it wouldn't have escalated to the situation that it was, and they didn't need a whistleblower to blow it all out of proportion and the great reputation damage and all. So yes, if it escalates, you need your rules and regulations and the proper channels and all. But let's all work toward a situation where we don't need it as much as we do right now.
Yeah, and just so in my practice, I've seen very few reports that were meant that were made on purpose to intentionally damage somebody or an organization. But yes, that can happen. It can happen. But I've seen very few of them.
Okay, thank you. Brechtje, I have another important question for you. And I know it's not going to be an easy one to answer. As you mentioned, many member states are going to be too late with the transposition into national laws. The Netherlands is one of them. Belgium is definitely going to be one of those. Now, do the citizens, and especially the whistleblowers, of course, get any rights from the directive? Because it's, or in other words, do the member states have any responsibility if they do not transpose the directive in time? Suppose you want to blow the whistle, you are part of a company with more than 250 employees, you want to blow the whistle on the 1st of, or let's take the 18th of December 2021, the 17th is the deadline, as you know. Do they have any rights? Are they protected at that time?
That is indeed a very difficult question to which I do not know the answer, because that basically touches upon what is the effect of member states being too late with the implementation of directives and the penalties and attached to that. What I can think of is an act in tort against the Dutch government, but that is if you are an employee and you don't have a lot of money, it's a very costly exercise. So even though in theory that might be available, that route might be available, it's questionable whether employees will actually file such a claim. Also because whistleblowers are not after their, generally not after their own interest, but they do something out of the common interest, and to then finance a claim against the state out of your own pocket because of a technical fact, I'm not sure whether that is really, really realistic. But this is really a matter of general EU law expertise, and I don't. I know a lot about employment law, and I know a lot about whistleblowing, but I this is not my expertise. Sorry.
No problem. I think we will need to wrap up. remains for me to thank everybody, the organizer, EQS, all the speakers, the audience, and see you next time. Thank you very much. Bye-bye. Thank you.